Subject of Atomic Physics, Lecture Number 15, SEM, The Special Theory of Relativity. The Galilean Transformation and Mechanics. In classical physics, the state of a mechanical system at some instant can be described completely by constructing a frame of reference and using it to specify the coordinates and the time derivative of the coordinates for the particles comprising the system and this instant. If we know the mass of the particles and the forces acting between them, Newton's equations of motion take it possible to calculate the state of the system at any future time in terms of its state and initial time. Now, it is often desirable that during or after such a calculation we specify the state of the system in terms of a new frame of reference, which is moving in translation, it is not rotating, relative to the first frame with constant velocity. Two questions arise. First question, how do we transform our description of the system from old to the new frame? Second question, what happens to the equations which govern the behavior of the system when we make the transformation? These questions are the ones with which the special theory of relativity concerns itself. Figure 1 shows a particle or mass m whose motion under the influence of force F is specified in terms of primed and unprimed frame of reference. The primed frame is moving relative to the unprimed frame with constant velocity v in direction which by construction is the positive direction of the collinear x asterisk and x axis. By definition, the times t asterisk and t measured in the two frames are both zero at the instant when the y asterisk z asterisk plane coincides with the y z plane. With these two frames, there are two sets of four numbers, x asterisk, y asterisk, z asterisk, t asterisk, and x, y, z, t, that can equally be used to specify the coordinates of the particle at any instant of time. What are the relations between the sets of numbers? According to classical physics, they are x asterisk equal x minus v multiplied t, y asterisk equal y, z asterisk equal z, t asterisk equal t. Formula number 1. This is known as the Galilean transformation. Figure 1. An x asterisk, y asterisk, z asterisk, t asterisk frame of the reference moving in translation with constant velocity v relative to an x, y, z, t frame. The simple arguments of classical physics leading to them are: first, if the zeros of the time scales used in the different frames are defined to be the same at any time and location, then in classical physics both time scales will remain the same for all times and all locations, so t asterisk equal t. Second, since by construction the x asterisk, y and x, y planes always coincide, we have z asterisk equal z, and similarly for y asterisk equals y. Third, since in this time interval between 0 and t asterisk equals t, the y asterisk z asterisk plane moves in the positive direction at distance v multiplied t, the x asterisk coordinate will be smaller than the x coordinate by the amount. So x asterisk equals x minus v multiplied t. The Galilean transformation constitutes the answer that classical physics gives to the first question posed earlier. The answer to the second question is given in classical mechanics by using the Galilean transformation to convert Newton's equations in the x, y, z, t frame. Formula number 2. Into whatever form these equations assume in the x asterisk, y asterisk, z asterisk, t asterisk frame, note that for two formula to be valid, the x, y, z, t frame must be an inertial frame It is one in which a body, not under the influence of force and initially at rest, will remain at rest. By differentiating each of the first three of formula number one twice with respect to t, and then using the force to write t equals t asterisk, is trivial to show that. Next formulas. In other words, the acceleration of the mass m measured in the primed frame is the same as it is when measured in the unprimed frame. Of course, the reason is that two frames related by a Galilean transformation are not accelerating with respect to each other. So the transformation does not change the measured acceleration. Furthermore, f sub x asterisk equals f sub x, f sub y asterisk equals f sub y, f sub z asterisk equals f sub z. Because the component of the first f acting on the m in the direction of the x asterisk or x axis is the same as the seen in a z frame, and similarly for its other components. Evaluating all the unprimed components on acceleration and force in formula number 2 in terms of their primed counterparts, but doing nothing to the mass, since the classical mass for physics mass is an intrinsic property of the particle whose value cannot depend on the frame of reference. We find the equations of motion in the primed frame. Formula number 3. Note that formula 3 have exactly the same mathematical form as formula number 2. Thus, part of the answer to the second question is that Newton's equations, which govern the behavior of the mechanical system, do not change with we make a Galilean transformation. The x, y, z, t frame was an inertial frame because d2x over dt equals d2y over dt equals d2z over dt if f equals 0. From formula number 3, we see that x asterisk, y asterisk, z asterisk, t asterisk is also an inertial frame because d2x asterisk over dt equals d2y asterisk over dt equals dt d2z asterisk over dt of if f equals 0. Since Newton's equations are identical in any two inertial frames, and since the behavior of a mechanical system is governed by these equations, it follows that the behavior of all mechanical systems will be identical in all inertial frames. Also, these frames move at constant velocity with respect to each other. This prediction is verified by a wide variety of experimental evidence. The Galilean transformation and electromagnetism. Electromagnetic phenomena are treated in classical physics in terms of Maxwell's equations, which govern their behavior just as Newton's equations govern the behavior of the mechanical phenomena. We shall not actually carry through the Galilean transformation of Maxwell's equations as we have for Newton's, since the calculation is complicated. Instead, we shall state the results. Maxwell's equations do change their mathematical form under a Galilean transformation, in sharp contrast to the behavior of the Newton equations. It is known that Maxwell's equations predict the existence of electromagnetic disturbances which propagate through space in the characteristic manner of wave motion. The 19th century physicists, who were very mechanicist in their outlook, felt quite sure that the propagation of waves predicted by Maxwell's equations requires the existence of a mechanical propagation medium. Just as sound waves propagate through a mechanical medium, so according to their view, electromagnetic waves must propagate through a mechanical medium, which they called the ether. The propagation medium was required to have quite strange properties in order not to disagree with certain known facts. For instance, it would have to be massless, since electromagnetic waves such as light can travel through vacuum. but it would have to have elastic properties to be able to transmit the vibrations inherent in the idea of the wave motions. Nevertheless, physicists of that era felt the concept of the ether was more attractive than the alternative of electromagnetic wave propagating without the aid of the propagation medium. It was assumed that the electromagnetic equations in the form presented by Maxwell were valid for the frame of the references addressed with respect to the ether, the colored ether frame. A solution of the equations led to a prediction of the magnitude of the propagation velocity of electromagnetic waves in vacuum. The result was 2.998 multiplied 10 to 8 power meter second. In agreement with an experimental error with the value of the velocity of light that had been measured by Fizeau. However, in a frame of reference moving with constant velocity with respect to the ether, Maxwell's equations changed form when the Galilean transformation was used to evaluate them in the moving frame. As might be expected, when these changed equations were used to obtain a prediction of the electromagnetic wave propagation velocity that will be measured in the frame moving with respect to the ether. The velocity was found to have a magnitude different from c. The complicated calculation which predicted the velocity of the light measured in a frame of reference moving with respect to the ether, performed by making a Galilean transformation of Maxwell's equations to the moving frame and then solving them in that frame, led to the simple prediction. V sub light WRT moving frame equals V sub light WRT ether minus V sub moving frame WRT ether, formula number 4, where WRT with respect to and V sub light WRT ether equals C. The prediction agreed with two simple physical ideas. First, light propagates with a velocity of fixed magnitude c with respect to its propagation medium. The ether, just as sound waves propagate with a velocity of fixed magnitude with respect to the propagation medium, the air. Second, the velocity of light with respect to a frame moving with respect to the ether can be found from a normal vector addition of relative velocities. It should be pointed out that the arguments justifying vector addition of velocities are rarely the same as the justifying the Galilean transformation. For instance, in a case when all motion is along the x asterisk or x axis, formula number 4 can be obtained immediately by the time differentiation of the first of formula number 1 using also the first one, t asterisk equals t. In summary, theoretical physics near the end of the 19th century was based on the three fundamentals: Newton's equations, Maxwell's equations, and the Galilean transformation. Almost everything that could be derived from these fundamentals agreed well with the experiment that had been performed to the time. With regard of the questions we have in discussion, they predicted the reference frames of uniform motion with respect to each other were completely equivalent as far as mechanical phenomena was concerned, but in regard to electromagnetic phenomena, they are not equivalent. There was only one frame, the ether frame, in which the velocity of light had a magnitude with a numerical value c. The Michelson-Morley experiment. In 1887, Michelson and Morley carried out an experiment which proved beyond extreme importance. The experiment was designed to investigate the motion of the earth with respect to the earth as a frame. Since the earth is moving about the sun, it would seem unrealistic to make the a priori assumption that the earth frame travels with the earth, and as we shall indicate later, experimental observations arguing against such an assumption were known at the time. It would be much more reasonable to assume that the Aether frame was at rest with respect to the center of mass of the solar system, or the center of mass of the universe. In the first case, the velocity of the Earth with respect to the Aether frame would have a magnitude of the order of 10 to 4 power meter second. In the second case, the magnitude of the velocity will be somewhat greater. The basic idea of the experiment was to measure the velocity of light in two perpendicular directions from a frame of the reference fixed to the S. A moment's consideration of the classical theory, as summarized by the vector addition formula number 4, will show that the theory predicts the measured velocities should have different magnitudes for light traveling in different directions relative to the direction of motion of the observer through the ether. Also, the difference in the two measured light velocities was expected to be small, because the velocity of the ether with respect to the ether is small compared to the velocity of light with respect to the ether. Nicholson and Morley built a device incorporated an interferometer which should be more than sensitive enough to detect and measure the difference. To the extreme surprise, they could not even detect a difference. They and many other subsequent investigators repeated the measurement with improved equipment, but in effect was never. Predictions of the classical theory, the Michelson-Morley experiment showed that the velocity of light has the same magnitude c measured in the perpendicular direction in a reference frame which is presumably moving through the ether frame. The ether drag hypothesis assumed that the ether frame was locally attached of all bodies of finite mass. It was attractive because it will explain the Michelson-Morley results and yet did not involve modification of the existing theories. But it could not be accepted for several reasons, the principal one having to do with the astronomical phenomenon called stellar aberration. It had been known since the 1700s years that the apparent oppositions of the stars move annually in circles of a very small diameter. This is a purely kinematical effect due to the motion of the Earth about the Sun. In fact, it is the same as the effect causing a vertical shower of rain to appear to a moving observer to be falling at an angle of the vertical. From this analogy, it is easy to see that a stellar aberration would not be present if light were to travel with velocity of the fixed magnitude with the respect of the ether frame, and if that frame were dragged along by the S. In the emission theory, Maxwell's equations are modified in such a way that the velocity of the light remains associated with the velocity of its source. These two would explain the Michelson-Morley result, since the light source was fixed on the interferometer used to measure the light velocity difference, but it must be rejected because in conflicts with astronomical measurements concerning binary stars. Binary stars are pairs of stars which are rotating rapidly about their common center of mass. Consider such a pair at a time when one is moving toward the Earth and the other is moving away. Then, if the emission theory is valid relative to the Earth, the velocity of the light from one star will be larger than that light from the other star. This will be because the stars of a pair to move in very unusual orbits. However, in 1913, De Sitter showed that the observed motions of binary stars are accurately accounted for the Newtonian mechanics when the velocity of the light they emit is taken to have a magnitude independent of their motion. All the experimental evidence, including evidence from a number of highly accurate contemporary experiments, is consistent only with the conclusion that there are no special frame of reference. The ether frame was a unique property with the velocity of light measured in the frame alone has a magnitude equal to c. Just as for inertial frames and mechanical phenomena, all frames is relative motion with constant velocity are equivalent, in that the velocity of light measured in each frame has the same magnitude c. To succinctly put the experimental evidence, the velocity of light in vacuum is independent of the motion of the observer and of the motion of the source. Einstein postulate. Einstein in 1905 was the first of the realize the physicist should be abandoned the fruitless and misleading concept of the ether. In essence, he accepted the fact that the light propagates through vacuum, and that vacuum really is empty. With no ether frame, the only frame of reference that can have any significance of the observer measuring the velocity of light is the frame fixed relative to himself. Then it is no surprise that the observer in all cases obtains the same numerical result, c. When he measures the magnitude of the velocity of light, Einstein stated as a postulate, the laws of electromagnetic phenomena as well as the laws of mechanics are the same in all inertial frames of reference, despite the fact that these frames move with respect to each other. Consequently, all inertial frames are completely equivalent for all phenomena. This postulate required that Einstein modify either Maxwell's equations or the Galilean transformation, since the two together imply the contrary of the postulate. Also, in 1905, the emission theory could still be considered exactly. He chose not to modify Maxwell's equations. He was then forced to modify the Galilean transformation. This was a bold move. The intuitive belief of the validity of the Galilean transformation was so strong that his contemporaries had never seriously questioned it. Yet, as we shall see, the very different transformation that Einstein adopted in lieu of the Galilean one is based on the relativistic physical considerations, whereas the Galilean transformation is grossly unrealistic. Another indication of the boldness of Einstein is that our early considerations imply that any modification of the Galilean transformation would require some compensating quantification of Newton's equations in order that the postulate continued to be satisfied for mechanics. We shall see soon that the results this leads to, but first we must study to the new transformation equations. Simultaneity. Consider the force of the Galilean transformations 1, which is T asterisk equals T. The equation says is the same time scale at all places and for all times of any two frames of reference moving uniformly with respect to each other. This is equivalent to saying that there exists a universal time scale for all such frames. Is this true? To find out, we must realistically investigate the procedure using the time measurement. There is a problem in determining the simultaneity of events which occur at separated locations. In fact, this is a key problem involved in setting up a time scale for the frame of references. There are a number of methods for determining simultaneity in individual locations. They surely all involve the transmission of signals between the two locations. If you had at our disposal a method of transmitting signals with infinite velocity, there would be no more or problem in determining the simultaneity of events occurring at separated locations than there is no doing is for events occurring at the same location. This is where the Galilean transformations goes wrong by implicitly assuming the existence of such a method of synchronization. In fact, there is no such method, since we have agreed to be realistic in developing a timescale. We must use real synchronization signals. Light or other electromagnetic signals are clearly the most appropriate because they have the same propagation velocity under all circumstances. This property enormously simplifies the process of determining simultaneity. Thus, were the lead to Einstein's definition of simultaneity of separated events. An event occurring at time t first and location x first is simultaneous with an event occurring at time t second and location x second. If light signals emitted at t first from x second and at t second from x second arrive simultaneously at the geometrically measured midpoint between x first and n second. This definition, illustrated in figure 2, makes a very reasonable statement that two separated events are simultaneously to an observer located at their midpoint if he sees them happening simultaneously. Note that the Einstein theorem of simultaneity in time does not have an absolute meaning independent of location in space, as it does in this classical theory. The definition ultimately mixes the times t first t second and the space coordinates x first x second. A consequence of this is that two events which are simultaneous when observed from one frame of the reference are generally not simultaneous when observed from a second frame of the reference, which is moving relative to the first. To see this, we consider a very simple thought experiment adapted from one used in by Einstein. Figure 3 illustrates the following sequence of the events from the point of view of the observer O, who is at a rest relative to the ground. This observer has so placed two charges of dynamite, C first and C second, and the distance O C first and O C second are equal. He causes them to explode simultaneously in his frame of reference by simultaneously sending out light signals to C1 and C2, which actuate detonators. He is invoking a replica of the definition quoted earlier. Assume that he does this so that on his frame the explosions occur when he is abreast of O asterisk and the observer stationed on a train moving by at a very high velocity v. The explosions leave marks C first asterisk and C second asterisk on the side of the train. After the experiment, O asterisk can measure the distance O asterisk C first asterisk and O asterisk C second asterisk. He must and will find that equal because otherwise space would not be homogeneous. The explosions also produce flashes of light. Observer O will receive the flash simultaneously, confirming that his frame the explosions occurred simultaneously. However, O asterisk will receive the flash which originated and C second asterisk before he receives the flash from C first asterisk, simply because the train moved during the finite time required for the light to reach him. Since the explosions occurred at points equidistant from O asterisk, but the light signals were not received simultaneously, he must conclude that his frame of reference, the explosions, were not simultaneous. Such disagreements concerning simultaneity led to interesting results. From the viewpoint of O, C first C second equals C first asterisk C second asterisk. But according to O asterisk, C second asterisk passed C second before C1 asterisk passed C1, since he received the signal from C second asterisk first. Therefore, O asterisk must conclude that C first C second less than C first asterisk C second asterisk distance. If this is not apparent, it can be demonstrated by constructing diagrams showing the sequence of events from the viewpoint of O asterisk. The simultaneity disagreement will also cause the two observers to disagree concerning the rates of clocks fixed on their respective frames of the reference. As we shall see, the nature of their disagreements about the measurement of distance and time intervals in such as to allow both O and O asterisks to find the same value C for the velocity of the light pulses which came from C1 or C2. Time dilation and length construction. We consider here a second so experiment designed to facilitate the quantitative evaluation of two relativistic effects that we noted qualitatively in the preceding so experiment. An observer O asterisk moving with velocity v relative to observer O wishes to compare a time interval measured by his clock with a measurement of the same time interval made by the clock belonging to O. They have already established that when addressed with respect to each other, all the clocks involved run at the same rate and they are synchronized. Now, it is apparent that even when in relative motion, the reading of an O asterisk clock can be compared with the reading of an O clock. That happens to be momentarily coincident with the former without any complication. These measurements are of a time interval made with clocks of the two frames can be compared by a procedure illustrated in Figure 4. O asterisk sends a light signal to a mirror which reflects it back to him. Both O and O record the emission of the signal with clocks C1 and C asterisk which are coincident and then instant. They use the clocks C second and C asterisk which are coincident when the light signal is received back from the mirror to record the time of its reception. The two events defining the beginning and end of the light interval to be compared are the emission and the reception of the light signal. The elapsed time between these two events measured by O asterisk in T asterisk equal 2 multiplied delta T asterisk, where delta T asterisk equals L asterisk divided C, with L asterisk the distance to the mirror measured in his frame. The elapsed time measured by O is T equals 2 multiplied delta T. From the figure and the Pythagorean theorem, it is apparent C square multiplied delta T square equals V square multiplied delta T square plus L square, where L is the distance of the mirror as measured by O. Solving for delta T, we have delta T square equals L square divided C square multiplied 1 divided 1 minus V square divided C square, or delta T equals 1 divided C multiplied 1 divided square root from 1 minus V square divided C square.